Thank you. Thank you. Well, how good it is to have Johnny Ray ministering to us in such an anointed way this morning. And I know my heart, I feel, is ready to go into God's Word. And we have prayed already, so we're going to be praying more as the service goes on. Thank you for those of you who are coming and supporting the needs of our church in prayer here at the front. And why don't you take your Bibles, if you would, please, and turn to the book of Ruth. If you're here for the, and you don't have a copy of God's Word with you, then I would just encourage you maybe to grab under the seat in front of you a Bible, and that will be a real blessing to you. You know, I swore that I would never do it, and but I'm embarrassed to say that I did. I used to actually mock and ridicule other people who did it, but sure enough, when I got my own kids, I played that silly little game, you know, where you put something up in front of your face and then you kind of hide it and you look out behind. I used to think that was so ridiculous. Look at those people making fools of them. But I did it. All three of my kids, and I was just like, peekaboo, peekaboo, peek. You want to do it? It's fun, isn't it? Go ahead. Go ahead and do it at the right time, though. Ready? Peekaboo. And it's so crazy. Like, I mean, but you know why you do it? It's because it makes them smile. And then that melts your heart. And I guess I didn't understand that. And that thought came to mind this week when I was studying the book of Ruth. Because here's a passage of scripture. There's four chapters in Ruth, about 85 verses. And we're going to study them all this morning. So we'll be here for about 4 hours, but it's going to be good. And I studied the whole book this week, and I'll tell you what. God's not in the book. God hardly shows up at all in the book of Ruth, but amazingly, like a mighty stream running underground at the end, God bursts forth, and it's phenomenal. And so I call this message Peekaboo, God Comes Through. And we're trying to break the human addiction to having to see always what God's doing, but to be able, listen, to be able to know by faith that God is working even, tell me, even when I'm not seeing it, right? And working, always working, whether I see it or not. And that is certainly the message of the book of Ruth. So we're going to go through this a chapter at a time and kind of look at the text. Now, just if you're in Ruth already, just to kind of put it in context, Ruth follows, first of all, the Pentateuch, the first five books of the Bible. In the first five books of the Bible, we learn about Adam and then Noah, and then God says, I'm going to have a nation for myself. And so there's Abraham and Isaac and Jacob, we studied a couple of weeks ago, who had 12 sons. And one of those sons was Joseph, and down to Egypt and back with 2 million people to take the promised land. So Joshua. And in the time between Joshua and King Saul, whom we studied back in October, there was a period of time where God ruled through what the Bible calls judges, and different judges were appointed. This was a horrific time to be living in the world. The book of Judges says over and over that it was a day in which every man did that which was right in his own eyes. Isn't that just like the day we live in? Every person doing what is right in their eyes. And it was during that time that Ruth lived her life. In fact, it's about 1,100 years before Christ. Now, there's four chapters, as I said, and I'd like to suggest to you that in each chapter, there's like four moves or four scenes. And we're going to go through all 16 of those. Text, 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 text. Then we're going to come back for the application. Now, all in favor of applying God's Word to our life? All right, but before you can know what it means to us, you got to understand what it means, you see? And so we're going to go through, I'm going to try to tell the story. You're going to have to stick with me, get your Bible open, or get one you can look at. Every person here with a Bible would love to share with you. So get your eyes, if you can, on a copy of God's Word, and let's begin in Ruth chapter 1, verse 1. I'm calling the first chapter, Bad Decisions, Tough Times. And of course, that's always the way with God. Bad decisions lead to tough times. Look at chapter 1, verse 1. In the days when the judges ruled, there was a famine in the land. And a man of Bethlehem in Judah went to sojourn in the country of Moab. He and his wife had two sons. Now, the name of this man is Elimelech. I got to get this out of my system right now. Every time I hear that name, Elimelech, I just want to go, Elimelech, Elimelech, Elimelech. Don't you? Okay, I've dealt with that. And this man, Elimelech, had two sons. He had a wife named Naomi and two sons. Here's the first move in the chapter. We'll call it famine. You see in verse 1 there was a famine in the land. They were living in a very wicked period of time of idolatry and apostasy and apathy. And then there was a famine. And so one day Elimelech woke up and he's like, you know what, we are out of here. And this is an awful place to live and there's no food. And they were living in Bethlehem. Ironically, the word Bethlehem means house of bread. And he made a very bad decision to run from the famine. Why did they have a famine? Well, they had a famine because God was trying to teach them something. And whenever we're going through difficult times and things are lean in your life for whatever reason, our first thought should not be to move to California. Our first thought should be, why has God allowed this season of poverty and what is God trying to teach me? But instead, he made a bad decision, and it was bad for two reasons. And number one, it was bad because of why he moved. He was running from God and from God's people. And secondly, it was a bad decision because of where he moved. Now, let me put a little map up on the screen and you can get sort of a feel for it. Bethlehem is just to the west of the center of the Dead Sea there. And Moab is just to the east of the center of the Dead Sea there. And so it wasn't very far that he moved. He moved only 50 miles. But look up here. It's hard for us to understand living in this day. But he couldn't have moved to a worse place, all right? He moved to Moab. Now, the Moabites were the descendants of Lot. And actually, tragically, the Moabites were the descendants of Lot through an incestuous relationship that he had with his oldest daughter, Genesis 19. And they were the arch enemies of the Lord's people. They had so punished them when they were coming up from Egypt. In fact, it'd be very similar today to the Jewish people fleeing to Palestine and joining forces with Arafat. You say, well, that would never happen. And that's how shocking it is what Elimelech did. And in Judges chapter 13, we learn that these Moabites had actually taken prisoner the whole nation of Israel for 18 years. And I mean, the suffering from that was hardly even faded in the memories. And off goes Elimelech with his wife and his two sons to Moab. Well, here's the second thing, not surprisingly, when you make such a drastic move against the will of God, the next move is called not a famine, but three funerals. And they get to town, and not surprisingly, this Elimelech, his name means my God is king. But God was not Elimelech's king. And it says in the scriptures here, you can see it in verse 5, chapter 1, or pardon me, even before that in verse 3, but Elimelech, the husband of Naomi, died. And then 10 years later, down in verse 5, both of the sons die, so that the woman was left without her two sons and her husband. You say, are you suggesting, James, that Elimelech went so far into rebellion that God actually took his life? He was a young man. And both of his sons died too? You say, well, does God really do that? Read 1 Corinthians 11. Read Acts chapter 5. Of course God does. And sometimes a person, listen, who is God's child, is so stubborn and so rebellious and so resistant that the only way God finally can choose to deal with that person is say, you know what, you're coming to heaven right now. We're going to face off about this. So Elimelech died, and his two sons died. It's pretty tragic, really. But the story's about to take a positive turn. Notice the next thing. It's interesting as you follow along. Look at verse 6. Because the men are now off the scene, and the women, who are as godly as their men were ungodly, the women are about to take over, and things are going to get a lot better. Amen, ladies? Come on, ladies, amen? Amen. The women are taking over, and we'll notice the major upgrade in chapter 1, verse 6. Ruth's first thought, it says, then she arose with her daughters-in-law to return from the country of Moab, for she had heard in the fields of Moab that the Lord had visited his people and given them food. So the third thing then clearly is Naomi goes home. There's a famine, there's three funerals, Naomi goes home. And you can see the story. She says to her two daughter-in-laws, I'm going to go back home. But all of a sudden she turns and she says to them in verse 11, but Naomi said, turn back, my daughters. Why will you go with me? Have I yet sons in my womb that they may become your husbands? Turn back, my daughters. Go your way, for I am too old to have a husband. And if I should say I have hope, even if I should have a husband this night and should bear sons, would you therefore wait till they were grown? You see, the whole focus of these women was wanting to give birth to children and to continue the line of their family. And so with their husbands dead, it was a very desperate scene. And so she does the obvious thing. She says, girls, you shouldn't have to be bound up with me. My husband has died. My sons have died. I'm going back to where I came from. Y'all should not be pressured to come with me. Interestingly, the daughter's name was Orpah. And she's like, well, okay. And she leaves and goes back home. But the other one, Ruth, the scripture says, clung to her. And interestingly, that leads us to this fourth part. Ruth goes with. And she says this amazing thing. Though her mother-in-law told her, go back to your own people, Ruth said in verse 16, do not urge me to leave you or to return from following you. For where you go, I will go, and where you lodge, I will lodge. Your people shall be my people, and your God, my God. Beyond that, she says, where you die, I will die, and there I will be buried. May the Lord, interestingly, that's God's covenant name, Yahweh. And so we understand that Ruth doesn't have some generic understanding of God. Your God shall be my God. This was a commitment of faith on her part. And she uses God's covenant name. May the Lord do so to me and more also, if anything but death parts me from you. Well, that's chapter 1. Bad decisions, tough times. And here comes Ruth and Naomi back toward Bethlehem and not sure of all that's going to happen even when they get there. But let's turn to chapter 2. I'm calling chapter 2, Love is in the Air. And everybody loves a love story. And God is not going to leave Ruth alone. And even though she can't see God working and the situation looks very desperate, here's the first move of chapter 2. Ruth goes gleaning. So they get back to Bethlehem. And of course, they left because they had no food. And they come back because they have no food. And arriving back home, their situation is pretty desperate. They have nothing. Think of it. And so Ruth says, I'm going to go out into the field. She goes out in the field for two reasons. Number one, she goes out to glean. Do you know about that? The book of Leviticus prescribes, let me get the exact chapters for you. The book of Leviticus prescribes that a person who was working in the fields should leave grain for poor people. Leviticus 19 and Leviticus 23, God commanded that they were not to harvest the corners of the field. And beyond that, after they had reaped the first round of the harvest, if there were stalks of grain that were missed, they were not to go back and pick up what they missed. The corners of the field and what they missed on the first time of the harvest was to be left there for the poor people. And that was Ruth. So out she went into the field to glean. But she didn't just want to glean. Look there in chapter 2. She wanted to glitter. She said, let me go into the field and glean among the ears, verse 2. After him in whose sight I shall find favor. And so she wasn't just looking for food. She was looking for a husband. Is that wrong? Absolutely not wrong. You're going to see in a moment just how incredibly virtuous her character is. Ruth goes gleaning. I called the next part, Boaz gets a clue. And Boaz is an older man, and let's say middle-aged and wealthy and successful. And he comes walking back from being in town one day, and all of a sudden he's walking through the field, and who does he see? Ruth. And he's like, check her out. Out. The exact phrase of that is right there in verse 5 of chapter 2. Notice, then Boaz said to his young man who was in charge of the reapers, whose young woman is this? Well, he was pretty excited to see this woman, and he thought, whoa. He's very much tuned into who she is. Notice this third section of chapter 2. Boaz wins Ruth with kindness. Now, men, listen up for a minute. Those of you young men, eligible men, you'd like to be married someday, Boaz is a phenomenal example for you. Stop trying to impress women and go to work to win one. And all the ladies said, amen. Don't impress the girls, win the girl that God would provide for you. And it's fantastic what Boaz does here. You can read all the details in chapter 2, but let me just point these out in verses 8 and 9. He gives her a place. Then Boaz said to Ruth, now listen, my daughter, do not go to glean in another field or leave this one, but keep close to my young women. Come, stay here. This is a place for you. You can be confident. Beyond that, he provides for her. There was great danger in this world of men. And he says in verse 9, let your eyes be on the field that they are reaping and go after them. Have I not charged the young men not to touch you? Protection. And then he even provides for her. And when you are thirsty, go in. Go to the vessels and drink what the young men have drawn. And so he wins her. But also, ladies, notice this. Notice that she responds incredibly with humility. And notice that it was not her looks, and certainly not her money, and not her connections that won Boaz, but it was her reputation. Notice in verse 11, but Boaz answered her, all that you have done for your mother-in-law since the death of your husband has been fully told to me, and how you left your father and mother and your native land and came to a people that did not know you before. The Lord repay you for what you have done, and a full reward be given you by the Lord, the God of Israel, under whose wings you have come to take refuge. That is fantastic. So Boaz wins Ruth with kindness. In fact, a little later on down the text, you can see they go on their first date. And at mealtime, Boaz said to her, verse 14, come here and eat some bread and dip your morsel in the wine. How romantic. I wonder if there was a candle. And love is in the air. Notice in verses 15 and 16, when she arose to glean, this Boaz, man, he's head over heels. He instructed his young men, saying, let her glean even among the sheaves. You mean the part we've already harvested and baled? You're going to let her go? He says, let her have whatever she wants, wherever she wants it, and do not reproach her. And also, pull out some from the bundles for her and leave it for her to glean. He's just like, as you're walking along, just throw a little trail behind you of all the good stuff. She's like, I am having a great day. Look at all this. He's winning her. Listen, and it's wonderful. And God is at work, though he's hardly been mentioned. And though Ruth would have reported such a desperate situation, Boaz wins Ruth with kindness. Then make a note of this. Ruth tells Naomi. Now, can't you just imagine her coming home after a day like this? And she's like, come here, you're not going to believe this. And I went out, and I met, and I saw, and in the field, and he, and oh, and you can't believe. And she's telling this whole story. Can't you hear the two of them? I'm so excited. Now, here's the most incredible part of the whole thing. When Naomi hears who it is that she's talking about, look in verse 20 of chapter 2. Naomi also said to her, this man is a close relative of ours, one of our redeemers. Now again, it's so hard for us to comprehend what was meant by that, but let me tell you, the redeemer was a very, very special person in the Old Testament. Every family had, outside of their own family unit, a husband and a wife and whatever children God blessed them with. There were relatives in line, a first and a second, maybe a third, who were in this position of redeemer. And the responsibility of the Redeemer was threefold. If the family fell upon hard times and were taken, as I taught you last week, as slaves because of their debt, the Redeemer was to come and was obligated to spend whatever wealth he had to buy that family out of that slavery. Secondly, if they had lost property, and we learn in the text that Elimelech had had some property. He had mortgaged it, gone to Moab. Of course, when Naomi came back, she didn't have any money to buy that property back. The Redeemer was the person who was supposed to come and buy back what had been taken because of debt and poverty. And then thirdly, and most incredibly, there was in the Old Testament this concept of leveret, L-E-V-I-R-A-T-E, leveret marriage. And I learned about this myself this week. And the responsibility of the Redeemer, because the compelling issue was descendants, male heirs, so that the name could be continued. And amazingly, God provided that if the husband died and no male heirs had been born, that the Redeemer was responsible if he was eligible for marriage. The first one in line, eligible for marriage, was to pick up that responsibility, marry that woman, and provide that she would have male heirs. And the man's name, the man who had passed away, that his family line would continue. And so, when Ruth came home and said, I met this guy and he just rocks and everything's so great. And she's like, who did you say it is? And she heard the name. And she's like, he's a close relative. He is one of our redeemers. I mean, it was like the most, and it was like all of a sudden the clouds break open and God shines down. It's phenomenal. Well, look what happens. Chapter 3. I'm calling chapter 3 Rendezvous at Midnight. Doesn't that sound like a title for a Hardy Boys novel? Rendezvous at Midnight, but it's exactly what happens. You can see at the end of chapter 2, so she kept close to the young women of Boaz, gleaning until the end of the barley and wheat harvests, and she lived there with her mother-in-law. And so this situation of, man, I can't believe you got all this gleaning. Girl, you are the best gleaner we have ever had in this town before. Not realizing, of course, all that Boaz was doing. And this went on for days and days and days until the harvest was over. Now, when the harvest was over, they would then take what had been gathered from the fields and they would go to the next step, which was threshing, separating out the wheat from the husk and the chaff. Think of it sort of like husking corn. And what they would do to thresh it would be they would beat it upon a rock and then throw it up into the air in a position where the wind could strike it, and the chaff would blow away, and the wheat would fall to the threshing floor. And so it's interesting, Naomi comes up with this incredible plan. She says to Ruth, in effect, at the beginning of chapter 3, girl, time is wasting. And you know how men are. And he's not going to make a decision. We got to do something here to give him a little heads up. He's a relative. Your husband's gone. This is his responsibility. He needs to step up and do his job. And so she comes up with this plan. She says in those first verses there, you can see it. She says, Boaz is going to be winnowing tonight. So wash and put some perfume on. Get a nice dress on. And wait until the end of the day when he lays down to sleep. And go and lay by his feet. That's Naomi's plan. Now notice Ruth's obedience. It says in verse 5 that Ruth replied, and she replied, all that you say I will do. Now look up here for a minute. There's a lot in that. Naomi is Ruth's authority covering. And though she's not a perfect woman, she's the woman that brought her to faith. And now she tells her, this is what you need to do. And though it was a difficult thing she was asking, Ruth's response, all that you say I will do. So she went down to the threshing floor and did just as her mother-in-law had commanded her. Verse 7, and when Boaz had eaten and drunk and his heart was merry, he went to lie down at the end of the heap of grain. He was exhausted from the day's work and he'd eaten. Then she came softly and uncovered his feet and lay down. Now some have tried to imply from this some inappropriate, seductive sort of movement on Ruth's part. Listen, nothing could be further from the truth. And again, we have to understand this is 1100 years BC, and the customs that are unfolding. You can't understand the text without understanding the customs that back it up. And far from being inappropriate, Ruth is showing incredible integrity as a believer. Notice, first of all, that she did not marry outside the family. It was quite a commitment for a young woman. Beyond that, there's no indication that she did in any way engage in any immorality. And thirdly, she appealed to an older man to take up his responsibility. Now, Boaz, as an older man, listen, this is key. Boaz would not have presumed that she would want to marry him. An older man and just kind of uncertain and not wanting to force the issue, and maybe she doesn't want a redeemer, and he's really very humble in the way that he handles all of it. But notice this thirdly then, Boaz's promise. She comes and she lays down at his feet. Verse 8, at midnight the man was startled. He's like, ah! And he turned over, behold, a woman lay at his feet. Now you got to know, okay, there was no night lights plugged into the wall here, okay? All right? It was pitch black. And they couldn't, you know, when you can't even see your hand right in front of your face? And he was startled that anything was at his feet. And you can even see in the text, he's like, who are you? Who's there? Yet only 2 feet away. And she answered, I am Ruth, your servant. Spread your wings over your servant, for you are a redeemer. Some of your translations are better than mine, I think, in this respect. Spread your wings actually is also translated the corners of your garment. Now, to just see how righteous the situation is, look at verse 10. And he said, may you be blessed by the Lord, my daughter. You have made this last kindness greater than the first, and that you have not gone after young men, whether poor or rich. You see the point he's making? He was waiting to see. There's such godliness here facing off in both directions. He was waiting. He knew what his obligation was. He was waiting to see if she desired to be with him. You have made this kindness greater than the first, in that you have not gone after younger men, whether poor or rich. Verse 11, and now, my daughter, do not fear. I will do for you all that you ask, for my fellow townsmen know that you are, you see it there? A worthy woman. And how God blessed her godliness. Some translations have that she was a virtuous woman. Others, a woman of excellence or a woman of noble character. Not only was she righteous, but listen, ladies, she was righteous to the letter. And God is honoring her for it. In fact, she goes home and, not surprisingly, gives the great news of Boaz's intentions to Naomi. And the fourth move of chapter 3 is waiting on God. Now they're waiting on God. And her mother-in-law says righteously at the end of verse 18 of chapter 3, wait, my daughter, until you learn how the matter turns out, for the man will not rest, but will settle the matter today. It's fantastic. Now here's chapter 4, and I love this heading. Marriage made in heaven. That's what this is. Marriage made in heaven. And some fantastic things happen in chapter 4. First of all, here's the first thing. A Boaz, the negotiator. I want to tell you something. This guy is slick. And I didn't show it to you earlier, but look at the end of the middle of chapter 3, where he says in verse 12 to Ruth there on the threshing floor, he says, and now it is true that I am a redeemer, yet there is a redeemer nearer than I. Remember in a line? He says, I'm a redeemer, but I'm not the first one. We got to handle this the right way. Remain tonight and in the morning. If he will redeem you, good, let him do it. But if he is not willing to redeem you, then as the Lord lives, I will redeem you. Isn't that great? So he gets up early in the morning, and I want to tell you, this is slick what he does. You can see in the beginning of chapter 4. So he goes down to the marketplace, you know, and he's got it all planned out in his mind what he wants to do. And Boaz shows up down in the marketplace, and he's like, hey, I heard that Naomi has a piece of property for sale. See, he's got an angle. And so the guy who's first in line goes, what? She's selling her property? Well, I'm the first person in line. I should have the property. And Boaz is like, yeah, you should have a sweet piece of property. And with it, you get Ruth. And but just remember that the kids that are born into that family, whatever you buy of her property, when they grow up, you just got to give it right back to them. You're not going to get to keep a nickel, man. And so the guy says, well, you can see it in verse 5 of chapter 4, then Boaz said that the day from that you buy the field from the hand of Naomi will also acquire Ruth the Moabite, the widow of the dead. Doesn't make that sound very attractive, does he? The widow of the dead. I think that's redundant. In order to perpetuate the name of the dead in his inheritance, that's what you want to give your life to? Then the Redeemer said, oh, I cannot redeem it for myself, lest I impair my own inheritance. Take my right of redemption yourself, or I cannot redeem it. And he's like, yes. Now, this was the custom in former times in Israel concerning redeeming and exchanging to confirm a trans. Now, isn't it interesting? Might I just have you note something? Look up here in verse 7. Do you see how customs change? So much so that when the book of Ruth was written, even when it was originally written, the customs had changed so much that he had to explain this. Do you see? Not surprising that this many years later, we're having to explain some of them. Now, this was the custom in former times in Israel concerning redeeming and exchanging. To confirm a transaction, the one drew off his sandal and gave it to the other. And this was a matter of attesting in Israel. So the guy who was first in line takes off his sandal and he holds it out to the guy, and everybody's watching, and he's saying, I'm giving up my rights. I'm giving up my rights to the property. I'm giving up my rights to Ruth. Everyone see? I'm giving them up. And Boaz was like, yoink. And he just takes the sandal and he says, it's done. And of course, he's pretty happy about the deal that he's made. The second thing, the deal is made. And how great. And how his heart must have rejoiced as he brought the news to Ruth. So much so, look down at verse 11. Here's the third thing, the people rejoice. Then all the people who were at the gate and the elders said, we are witnesses. May the Lord make the woman who is coming into your house like Rachel and Leah, who together built up the house of Israel. And so they pray for God to bless them with children. And then this fourth thing, and so critical, stay with me right now because we're at the peekaboo part. The fourth move is heirs. Heirs? Who cares? And the answer is, we do. This whole story is about to come to an incredible climax. Look at verse 13. So Boaz took Ruth, and she became his wife. And he went into her, and the Lord gave her conception, and she bore a son. Then the woman said to Naomi, blessed be the Lord who has not left you this day without a redeemer, and may his name be renowned in Israel. Of course, Naomi was concerned, having lost her husband and her sons, that there'd be no heir in her family. And so they even prophesy really there that this boy who's born, he shall be to you a restorer of life and a nourisher of your old age. For your daughter-in-law who loves you, who is more to you than seven sons. Now just think about that for a moment. If it was all about the heir, what wealth would seven sons be? And to have it said that this Ruth was worth more. What a compliment to this woman. More than seven sons has given birth to him. Then Naomi took the child and laid him on her lap and became his nurse. And the women of the neighborhood gave him a name, saying, a son has been born to Naomi. And they named him Obed. He was the father of Jesse, the father of, what's it say? And again, so hard for us to be able to appreciate, but honestly, it's like you're reading the book, and you're like, hey, he was the father of Jesse, and he was the father of, what? What? Who? This story, these random people, these just regular everyday people. King David. Goliath. The man after God's own heart. You've got to be kidding me. This lady, this Moabite lady, and Naomi, and poverty, and two sons dead, and coming home with nothing. But Boaz, but Obed, and Jesse, and David. Now the incredible thing is that the person who wrote the book of Ruth, and tradition says it was Samuel, but we don't know. The person who wrote the book of Ruth doesn't know the half of it. Because 30 generations later, 28 greats, go ahead, great, 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 Jesus Christ, the Lord, born to this family. Incredible. Peekaboo. And the word for us is this. God is working. God is working. Even when I can't see it. Even when I don't have. Look at those women in that secret place, faithfully hammering out their lives, doing what was right, with no apparent reward or blessing in any way, but God smiling down upon them and blessing their lives in ways that they probably never even understood until they got home to be with the Lord. Okay, ready for life application? All in favor of life application? There's four main characters in the story. Say four. And one of them's you. So let's find out which one is you, all right? Finding myself in the book of Ruth. Let's start with Orpah. Remember the sister who turned back? Orpah. By the way, did you know that Oprah Winfrey's parents, they named her after Orpah? And actually, the letters got, what do you call that? On the birth certificate, and so Orpah became, you don't even care about this, do you? Okay. Here's the lesson from Orpah's life, all right? Here it is. Don't quit or you'll miss the miracle. Got it? Don't quit or you'll miss the miracle. Chapter 1, verse 14 says that they lifted up their voices and wept as Ruth prepared to go back home to Bethlehem. Listen. They wept. These women had been through a lot. Naomi had lost her husband. They'd lost their two husbands. Listen, they'd been through a lot of separation. Now facing yet another separation, they were torn. Should they leave Naomi or should they leave their homeland? Notice at the end of verse 14 in chapter 1, Orpah kissed her mother-in-law. Ruth clung to her. I'm telling you, that is a pivotal moment in the history of those two women's lives. And you think about the choices that we make. Little choices. Orpah was never heard from again. Maybe she never even heard the name Boaz. Maybe she never even knew about Obed. We don't know really what happened to her. But I would just ask you this. Don't quit or you'll miss the miracle. See, this decision that Orpah was making was not a geographical decision. It was a matter of faith. Do you remember what Ruth said? She said, I'm going to stick with you and with your God. Your God shall be my God, she said. This wasn't a geographical thing. This was a decision of faith. And Orpah was deciding whether she was going to follow the God that Naomi had told her about, or whether she was going to, well, you can see it right in the text, chapter 1. Ruth says this word, see, your sister-in-law has gone back to her people and her, what's it say? And her gods. Listen, this was a faith decision. And I wonder how many, look up here, I wonder how many of you are here this morning and you've heard the good news about Jesus Christ, that your sins can be forgiven if you repent and come to Him by faith. And you've heard this again and again and again, but you sit here and stop, listen, one step short of true conversion. And so I ask you this morning, are you Orpah? You have the information. You have the opportunity. But you have not exerted your will toward the cross of Jesus Christ. And if you were to go out of here today and something tragic were to happen to you, you would be Orpah and you would go into a Christless eternity because you did not exercise your will by faith in regard to these things that you've heard. One step short of a miracle. And how many people up and down these rows would plead with you to make the decision today to turn to Jesus by faith. We've had our lives changed, amen? And listen, this could happen to you. You don't have to be Orpah in a room of Ruths. Don't stop one step short of a miracle. If you agree with that, say amen. Amen. Don't stop one step short. This could be your day. What's the date today? December 8th, 2002. This could be your day, known from eternity past, your day, to step toward the cross of Jesus Christ. Have your life changed by a miracle. Well, you say, James, I've made that decision, but sometimes I'm just not living with the Lord as I should, and I know it. Let me ask you this. Are you Naomi? Don't let your feelings dictate your faith. And Naomi is a good example of many things in the story, but she really struggled. I understand that. Notice in chapter 1, when she gets back to Bethlehem, the people come out and said in verse 19, "Is this Naomi?" She said to them, "Do not call me Naomi, call me Mara, for the Almighty has dealt very bitterly with me. I went away full, and the Lord has brought me back empty. Why call me Naomi when the Lord has testified against me, and the Almighty has brought calamity upon me?" She wasn't doing very good. And humanly speaking, we can look at her situation and have compassion for her, can't we? Her husband, both of her sons. But listen, she could not have been more wrong about her life. And she was taking a snapshot in a moment, and it seemed as though the Lord had dealt bitterly with her. But man, what God has got in store for her. It's incredible. But she couldn't see it. But God is working even what? And we don't see it. I had a pretty rough day this week. Wednesday. I was out of town again, and I've really got my calendar together in the new year, but I really just didn't want to be away, and it was the third day away, and I don't know, I can't explain to you. I woke up Wednesday, everything was lame, and why am I not home? And there were some people that were just making me nuts, and I had a bad attitude. I just kind of had a bad attitude. And about midday on Wednesday, I was like, "Listen, I can't believe it, dang it," you know, and all that. Don't look at me like that. And I wasn't doing. I got home, and does your family ever do this to you? My wife and my kids were like, "Stay away from him. I don't know what's wrong with you, but it's not going to be near me." So I woke up Thursday morning, and I spent some time with the Lord, got my heart squared away where it needed to be, and acknowledged this, my attitude wasn't that good. And the Lord really helped me with it. And but what if I hadn't done that? And what if that day had to become 3 days? And what if those 3 days had to become a week? And what if that week had to become a month? Thank God Naomi didn't do that, because we see later on, and this is the thrilling thing about her, when Ruth comes home from the gleaning with the good news, notice what Naomi says in chapter 2, verse 20. Naomi said to her daughter-in-law, "May he be blessed by the Lord, whose kindness has not forsaken the living or the dead." You see her humility there? I was wrong. Those things I said about calling me Mara, I was wrong. My attitude was wrong. I judged God harshly because I couldn't see what he's doing. And now the clouds have opened. And God is being faithful. "May he be blessed by the Lord, whose kindness has not forsaken the living or the dead." Let me just ask you, have you been on the roller coaster? What's God doing? What's God doing? What's God doing? Up and down, up and down. Are you Naomi? I had a day of Naomi this week. I don't have very many of those. Maybe you've had a week or a month or more. Look. Don't let your feelings dictate your faith. God is working. Amen? Amen. You say, "No, I don't think that's me." Okay, then. Are you Boaz? Choose the right. God blesses obedience. This is thrilling. How easily this book could have been called Boaz. It's his story too. Here was a man who was wealthy, successful, and single. Can I just review those words with you? Here was a man who was wealthy, successful, and single. Man, he could have been singing, "I love the nightlife. I've got to boogie." But instead, he chose to be a man of righteousness and a man of integrity. And you could have looked at Boaz before Ruth came to town, and you could have been, "Man, what a loser. Life is passing you by. You are missing an opportunity." And he would have said, "No, no, no, no. I am trusting in God, and I am waiting on God, and God was going to meet my needs. It's fantastic. Think of the temptations he must have faced, the pressures that he must have felt. And then to think, did he even live to see his grandson? Did he even know the part about David? It's doubtful. But look how God blesses obedience. He was the grandfather or the great-grandfather of David and the great-great-great-great-great-grandfather of, tell me.
Wow.
God blesses obedience. Maybe you're here this morning and you've been facing a temptation in your life. Look up here. Maybe this week, you thought of doing something that could devastate your family. Listen. That everything that you've wanted to be about could be lost, what? In a moment. God help us to be men and women of integrity and to do what is right, even when it's hard. Listen, God blesses obedience. You stay on the stuff. You keep doing what God's called you to do, even when it's hard, even when you're not seeing it. And lastly, are you Ruth? No doubt she is the star of this story. Step out in faith. God will reward you. That's the story of Ruth's life. I mean, you got to admit, the girl had an unstoppable, unquenchable faith. And she wasn't some Christian for 30 years, you know. She was a pretty new believer. But she just knew what God was about. And she was determined to test the faithfulness of God. I wrote these three things down. She makes an incredible pledge to the woman who gave her the good news when she says, your God will be my God, your people will be my people. And God, judge me if anything but death separates us. Then she goes out to glean grain in a man's world. So dangerous that chapter 2, verse 9 and chapter 2, verse 16 both mention the danger of her being assaulted, implying molested. And yet she had no choice. She wasn't presumptuous. She had no choice. And she went out by faith, and God honored and met her right there. And then thirdly, when she went down to that threshing floor, she didn't know if she'd be accepted or rejected. She didn't know. She followed her mother-in-law's counsel. She obeyed the cultures and the customs of her day. Yet she could have easily been rejected. Boaz could have woke up and go, what are you doing near me? But she did what was right and what she was asked to do, and God honored her for that. She took a risk. So let me ask you this finally then. If you're Ruth, there's some decision, you've been putting it off, you need to make it. Listen, a decision of faith. I've heard it said that we should live our lives in such a way that if God's not who he said he is, we'll fall flat on our face. And maybe you're here this morning and God wants you to step out and make some bold decision of faith. You've been putting it off, and God's like, go for it and trust me.